Meet the three men who want to be mayor of Kansas City for the next 4 years. We take our cameras inside the only debate before this upcoming mayoral election and truth check the candidates' answers. Plus, just as the city now puts out a national call for reuses for Kemper, how will plans to put a prison next door to the arena impair that marketing effort? And Brownback back in the spotlight this week, but for unpredictable reasons. Welcome, everyone. I'm Nick Haines. Those stories and more coming up as we connect the dots on the news of the week with Kansas City Star City Hall reporter Lynn Horsley, Steve Vockrodt from The Pitch, Kansas City Call senior writer Eric Wesson, and Star reporter, columnist, and blogger Dave Helling. Now, one of them is already in the job. The other is a well-known transit activist. The third likes to call himself the General. They are the three men campaigning for mayor of Kansas City, Missouri. And this week, all three met for the first and only time before the primary election just around the corner on April 7th. Todd Feeback from KCPT's Hale Center for Journalism captured the debate at All Souls Church at 45th and Walnut.
I take it for granted. I came out here to look for a change the way the city should be ran and to make it a better city. Can we agree on that?
Yes.
All right. In order to do that, we have to work together and labor together. Can we agree on that?
Yes.
Now, how are we going to run this city? Together. Where everything we do together, it means something to make a city brighter that sits up on the hill.
4 years ago, I came to you and asked you to join with me so that we could work together to get some things done in the city. We have, over those 4 years, been able to accomplish a great deal. Not everything is perfect, but then again, nothing ever is. As a result of our efforts of working together, you have a more efficient government. You have a budget that is tighter. You have financial stability. We changed some things with pension. You have rail coming out of the ground for the first time since the 50s. We have an optimistic attitude. We have young people moving back to the city. We have fun. We had the Royals. Can't take credit for all of that, but what the heck, why not?
Mayor James is a very intelligent man, very accomplished attorney. He's not a lazy mayor. He works hard. And he can dance. But Mayor James can't lead. He doesn't listen to the voters, the people. He's run a boss-style administration. He's had a demeanor that when he's challenged, he kind of has a huffy, puffy attitude. And his vision has not inspired the people.
Okay, an excerpt from the only debate featuring all three candidates for mayor of Kansas City. Who is this man, by the way? We see Sly James and we recognize Clay Chastain, but Vincent Lee, who likes to be called the General, why and who is he? Eric?
I didn't even know his name was Vincent Lee till I saw the ballot, because I've always known him as the General. He's just a guy that wants to fit in wherever he can fit in. I think he's run for just about everything but the Democratic nomination for president. He's just a community guy that gets around. I don't think he has a chance. And people say he had problems even getting the signatures to get on the ballot. But he's a nice guy. He's comical. But he has no vision on what to do and how city government should work.
Now, Clay Chastain, in his opening remarks that we just saw, Lynn Horsley, calling Mayor James an arrogant leader who doesn't listen to the people. Now, if that's the sentiment that Mayor James has lost touch with the constituents, why is it that there isn't this huge swath of people coming forward, these big names running against him?
Well, you'll recall that former City Councilman Dan Coffrin did ponder running against him. Sly has a very hefty war chest. He's got over $400,000 in the bank. And so anybody that wants to really challenge him realistically needs to raise money. And that's hard to do in this town. Sly is pretty popular with most people in the city. He's not had any huge mistakes. And so, Clay can say that the mayor is not popular, but I don't think that's accurate. Now, I will say the mayor he's not universally liked, and he has rubbed some people, especially in the black community, the wrong way. They don't feel he's done enough for the East Side. That's been a criticism of every mayor probably for 50 years. But this is the strangest mayor's race in decades. Clay Chastain doesn't even really live here. And we have another man, the general, who most people don't know. I've never seen him at City Hall. He has no business running for mayor. So what's your choice?
Now, we tried to bring all three of the candidates on this show, Steve Vockrodt, and I was speaking to Clay Chastain. You know, he wasn't even that enamored about coming on to do a debate himself in the primary.
No, and I talked with him, and I called him last week, and he was driving here, and he stopped in Kentucky to return my call. And, you know, his whole thing is, if I get elected, I'll move to Kansas City. And when I sort of needle him a little bit about, you know, living in Virginia and how seriously are you taking this campaign when you're spending most of your time in a different time zone, and he thinks that's kind of irrelevant. Well, he can hold that view. I don't know if the voters will see it that way. You'll notice that his support as a transit activist shifted quite a bit when he moved out of Kansas City. People were sort of like, who is this guy who doesn't even live here who's trying to dictate how we spend tax money?
But in news accounts this week, they're talking about this being the weakest mayoral field in decades, Dave Helling.
Yeah, I think that's probably right. I mean, you could argue that it isn't really a legitimate field at all, that Clay Chastain, who, by the way, defines huffy puffy when he's pressed on issues, is not, as Lynn and Steve others suggest, he doesn't really live in Kansas City. I've known Vincent Lee for a long time. He runs for office, he talks to reporters, but he doesn't get a lot of votes and doesn't really know how to get a lot of votes. So part of the reason for such a weak field is that the mayor in Kansas City is now term limited. So people who are thinking about taking on the mayor are thinking about waiting 4 years until the office is open. Now, that's not always the case. Mark Funkhauser, in his reelection year, faced a very strong field, including, of course, Sly James. So it's possible to beat an incumbent mayor, but you have to have the record almost like Mark Funkhauser of repeated problems and failures to give anyone a chance, and so folks
but
just
regardless of the strength of the field, everybody deserves to be held accountable, and so that's what we're going to try and do on this program. All Kansas City, Missouri residents, regardless of where they are employed, and all non-residents who work within the city limits are subject to a 1% tax on their gross earnings. That earnings tax, which will expire soon and will need to be renewed at the ballot box, was one of the questions the mayoral candidates were asked about this week. Should the city do away with it?
I think we need to increase it. Compared to where our city look and across the state line and all the defamatory things they say about their main city, I think they make enough money to give us a little bit more back to us.
We are taxed too much in this city. We are a city that drives off businesses and people because we have one of the highest tax rates in the nation. And I'm going to gradually eliminate the 1 cent earnings tax if I'm mayor.
Earnings tax constitute 40% of our general fund. The earnings tax is approximately the equivalent of the budget for the police department. Without the earnings tax, this city has a serious problem. There is no way, there is no method, there is no other tax that we could levy that will offset a loss of $200 million in our general fund.
Well, let's talk about that. I mean, some people argue that it is a huge disincentive to have this earnings tax in place, and that stops companies from coming into Kansas City, Missouri, Lynn.
That probably is the case. However, the mayor is correct that it would be very hard to replace those revenues. And if you think services are bad in this city now, think what they would be like if we lost $200 million. It is also, in essence, a regional tax. There are a lot of people who live outside of Kansas City but come into the city for its cultural assets or to work here. They use the city services. They should pay something, and the earnings tax is a way for making them to do that.
Eric.
I think baseball players, when they come into town and play, football players, professional athletes, they pay the tax as well. And the mayor is right. How else do you cover
But the idea that there's no other way to replace that money, Dave?
There is a way to replace it, because dozens of cities around the country pay their police and fire services without earnings taxes. You don't have to have an earnings tax or an income tax based on the where you live or where you work. So it could be replaced. The question always is, and always will be, is the replacement for the earnings tax more distasteful than the earnings tax itself?
Right.
Because you would have to do it somehow, sales taxes, property taxes. You couldn't cut $200 million out of the budget. You'd have to figure out another way to do it. And for the reasons that Lynn and Eric discuss, that is outsiders paying the tax, the earnings tax is very popular in Kansas City, as we saw the last time it was on the ballot, and there's no indication that's changed at all.
By the way, there are a lot of competitive council races also going on. Those candidates debate tomorrow at the Bruce R. Watkins Cultural Heritage Center, starting at 11 o'clock in a forum sponsored by the Call newspaper. It'll also feature two of the mayoral candidates, Sly James and Vincent Lee, but not Clay Chastain. And apparently they have a terrific moderator for that, Eric.
And that would be a guy named Nick Haines.
Now, Kansas City leaders say they're now conducting a national call for proposals in an effort to find a reuse for Kemper Arena. They're hopeful that a countrywide search will jog more interest and find a clear path for the event space. The mayoral candidates were asked about the future of Kemper in this week's debate, including what they would do to try and prevent the American Royal from leaving for Kansas.
I'll tell you, there is a ton of disagreement about what should happen with the Royal. There is a serious dispute as to whether or not the American Royal creates that kind of economic activity. As a matter of fact, their proposal in pro formas said $60 million, and that is not necessarily something we've been able to verify.
And they need us to come and stop playing games with the citizens of Kansas City. It's our dollars, our city, not theirs. It's ours. We got to work together to make it happen.
I say that we don't keep the American Royal. We let them go to Kansas or wherever they want to go. That proposal that they offered that was backed and signed by all the elite, if they want to fund a new facility for the American Royal, let them do it. The taxpayers aren't going to do that. That's my position. I think the more of the question also should involve or begs the question, what are we going to do with Kemper Arena if they do go somewhere else? And I think one of the things I was thinking about the other day, and I have, this is just off the top of my head, but it would be nice for the city to maintain that and work with Habitat of Humanity as a depository for leftover construction materials.
Now that Clay Chastain has spoken, is that what the city is now gonna do? Steve Vockrodt?
No, I doubt it. I think, you know, for Kemper Arena, they're going to try, as we mentioned earlier, that they're going to try and find somebody who's got a proposal for it. And the American Royal, as I understand, has not expressed much interest in participating in that process, which is kind of an interesting question for the American Royal. Why wouldn't you? If you were willing to ask for millions of dollars of taxpayer subsidy at one point, if it opens up to request for proposals, why don't you think your proposal can stand on its own two feet? Yeah,
the decision of the Royal to look elsewhere really lets Kansas City, Missouri off the hook, because mm-hmm. the whole reason that they kept Kemper open was to address the lease agreement between the Royal and the city that guaranteed some access for many, many years. And now that the Royal, in essence, has said, hey, we're going to go somewhere else, now the city can contemplate, I think, tearing it down. And ultimately, I think that's the decision that's going to have to be made, in part because it costs $1 million a year just to keep the thing open.
Eric?
Turn it into a parking lot. Just because they keep having a debate about what to do with it. Nobody has a valid idea. Just level it out, start over, and move on with it.
But they are looking for these reuse ideas now by having a more national profile, by advertising this nationally. But could those efforts to market the arena be marred now that a new prison is coming to the West Bottoms this fall? The Missouri Department of Corrections planning to turn a community release center in the area into a minimum security prison for around 400 inmates. But rather than cheering, why are many Kansas City businesses cheering this move?
Well, first of all, this facility is in the West Bottoms, but it's not right next door to Kemper
yes.
Arena. It's in a more industrial part of the West Bottoms, and it's surrounded by manufacturing facilities and other, you know, more industrial warehouse type facilities. And actually, for I think 18 years or since the mid-90s, it's been a release center where the people who were staying there were out of, you know, they had served their time, but they were released every day to go into downtown to try to look for jobs and housing. And often this released a criminal element into downtown, and the businesses were not too happy about that. This new facility will be a locked prison. So in many respects, the businesses think this will be better than what's there now. Another thing is it'll be a big boon for Kansas City because they send more than one ambulance a day to that facility. They had huge medical costs associated with that facility, even though it's not a city facility.
But
these are people
who have been released from prison who didn't have anywhere else to go. What happens to them now if they're going to put a prison there, Eric?
And that's a good question, whether they would go to Kansas City Release Center or they would just keep them in prison and then release them at another time, or maybe open up another halfway house for people transitioning out of prison into another part of the community. But usually where there's a prison, there's development around those prisons. There's Walmart. There's a bunch of things that you can do in those areas because families come and visit. Restaurants, fast food places generally follow prisons.
Now, you've been tracking this story as well, Steve.
Yeah, I wrote about this in 2013 because there was some concern downtown, as has been expressed by Lynn, about businesses having to, you know, particularly the CVS that's downtown. They had a lot of incidents where people in the halfway house were hanging out there causing trouble, and the police would come arrest them. They would give their address at 651 Mulberry, which is where the halfway house is. It's always difficult dealing with this issue. And one of the things I wrote about in 2013 was how, for the homeless population, they concentrated services in a particular area downtown. So if somebody comes in for a hot meal, they have a prospect of trying to get them, you know, for mental health evaluations or job or housing placement. And with the halfway house, they never really had anything like that. They just kind of, you know, get released at some point in the day. They're told, go find work, but not really a whole lot of support services. And so I think this development, as you said, is being cheered by the local businesses.
Well, the other thing was this facility got hundreds of people from the western side of the state, many of them with no ties to the Kansas mm-hmm. City area. They were just west of Jefferson City. And I believe that the intention is that the people who will be there once it becomes a prison will be more connected to the Kansas City area. They will have family here. So and as far as what happens to the other people that maybe didn't have Kansas City ties, they will go back to their own communities, and that may not be in the benefit of those communities.
In other news this week, the official inquiry is now complete, and Clayton, Missouri police say they have found no evidence of a whispering campaign or of political bullying against Missouri Auditor Tom Schweik. Detectives have combed through Schweik's computer and smartphone files and conducted interviews. The result, nothing. I think everybody is looking for a rational reason for an irrational act, but right now we're not finding anything, a detective tells reporters. Does this put a final end to this story, Dave Helling?
No, not as a political issue. And just to be clear, the police report isn't finalized yet. We have an open records request in for it. They haven't delivered it yet, so a final conclusion from the police, which would include an autopsy, has not yet been publicly released, at least to my knowledge. It remains an issue because John Hancock's role in whatever happened to Tom Schweik will undoubtedly be talked about by Democrats as we approach the 2016 campaign. I have a story this weekend about Jeff Rowe, the consultant who was involved in a radio ad that some believe may have contributed to Schweik's decision. He of course, is advising Catherine Hanaway. That will be an issue. When something like this happens, it is unexplainable, as we've discussed on this show. But that does not mean that it goes away as a political issue or that something people will think about and talk about as we approach the governor's election in Missouri next
Steve.
Year.
As far as the police and the comments that they've made, you have to sort of look at it in the context of what the police would be looking for in terms of evidence. You know, is there a possibility of a crime? I don't think anybody's really alleged that. Is there a document somewhere where, Mr. Hancock put something like this into writing that would constitute evidence of something like that? So the police finding, while I think Mr. Hancock was fairly happy with it, as he expressed on social media, does not really let him off the hook. And it certainly, you know, I don't think that really causes the discussion to go away.
I think it just puts a bookmark in it, and we'll revisit it again, probably, as Dave said, during the political season. But it doesn't really solve anything right now because the report's not final yet. And unless somebody else comes up and says, hey, Hancock called me, he said this, he said that, and the other, I think we'll be talking about it again in about a year and a half.
I did notice that Councilman Ed Ford started a civility campaign as a result of what happened in the death of Missouri Auditor Tom Schweik. Has that had an influence in any of the candidate campaigns for city council?
Well, not really. There was a back and forth between Teresa Lohr and Jay Hodges, who are two candidates for a city council seat. And one of them is working, I believe, with Jeff Rowe, and Teresa Lohr has a longstanding animosity towards Jeff Rowe. So there was a back and forth. It wasn't terribly civil. You know, I don't think the Kansas City Council races, though, for the most part, have had a lot of problems with name calling or acrimony.
Right. And just so we're clear, anyone who expects the Schweik suicide to dramatically impact the tenor of political discussion in this state or any other state are likely to be disappointed. I mean, in the first place, you can find people who will say that what Tom Schweik faced was not that unusual. Whispering campaigns take place all the time in politics. The ad was tough, but some people thought not over the line. I don't think you're going to see an overwhelming change in the way political campaigns are conducted in Missouri or any other state, for that matter.
I think in the 3rd District and the 5th District, in-district races, I think once we get past the primary, I think it'll be some gut shots come across.
Any whispering in the 3rd District?
Yeah, whispering in the 3rd and the 5th District about those in-district candidates and the at-large write-in candidate now.
Well,
I think those will be interesting.
And just to be fair, frequently negative advertising and negative campaigning works. And that's unfortunate, but if the voters want this to stop, they need to not vote for people that engage in this type of activity, and that doesn't happen.
This week, Kansas lawmakers get ready to send to the governor's desk bills enacting new restrictions on abortion and a measure permitting Kansans to carry concealed weapons without a permit or training. Governor Brownback has indicated he will sign both into law. No one would be surprised by that. But in what was a surprise announcement, the governor now says if he was presented with a measure to expand Medicaid in Kansas, he would likely sign the bill. Surprisingly, because Brownback has been a major opponent of Obamacare and for years has fiercely fought Medicaid expansion in the Sunflower State, arguing that despite the promises of huge federal dollars, what happens when that Washington money goes away and Kansas is left holding the bag? So why would Governor Brownback apparently reverse course on this key issue now? Steve?
Well, I think, you know, it's an interesting comment that he made, and, you know, I think he has some protection to a certain extent because I think he probably knows that it's not that likely anytime soon that such a bill would get to his desk. So, I don't know. I think it's, you know, we'll see if Medicaid expansion actually gets to
the governor's
office.
But even if he didn't
think
it was likely to come to his desk, doesn't this take away from his conservative bona fides by doing this?
And frankly, there's much less here than meets the eye. Barb Shelley has a story in the last couple of days that Governor Brownback is actually wants to take money from other places. It's just political.
So we shouldn't read too much into this?
No, we should
not. Even though there's been a slew of stories now, even from the state of Missouri, saying what the implications of this could be on the state of Missouri and how that might change there?
Missouri and Kansas are not going to expand Medicaid under Obamacare in the immediate future. They just aren't. They've talked about it. It's not going to happen.
All right. In the last few weeks, boosters of the American Jazz Museum here in Kansas City have been getting hot under the collar. Plans to dramatically cut funding to the 18th and Vine attraction is causing backers to argue that City Hall is about to deliver a death blow to the museum. But how long should venues in the city be subsidized? The Jazz Museum derives a third of its budget from Kansas City, Missouri taxpayers and has been open since 1997. Lynn Horsley, what's the status of this?
Well, they got a little bit of a relief. The City Council did approve a budget yesterday, and originally they were going to lose $125,000 from the city's allocation, which was 25%. That's been changed, and now they're only slated to lose $65,000. So the slashing of their funding has been alleviated to some degree. But I also think that the city feels like we've got a lot of basic services we need to provide. These museums and other assets do need to become self-sufficient, and I don't know how much longer they can count on this level of funding from the city.
People in the urban core are upset about it because they're saying, well, you give Power and Light District all this money, so now we've got this one thing that attracts people to downtown in the urban core at 18th Street, and you want to cut the funding so that people don't come.
But they were cutting $250,000 from the zoo, wasn't that correct?
Yeah, but the zoo gets tons of other money. Okay. They get county money. They get revenue from the gate from people coming in all
the
time.
Well, they have a tax, a dedicated tax
as well.
They did some improvements.
So,
but the fact is, You know, I was around when they built the Jazz Museum and they built the Negro League's Hall of Fame exhibits. And there was no planning then, and there is still no planning for ongoing operational costs. We built them without knowing how to pay for them. There's no budget for acquisition of exhibits publicly. So the original sin of the 18th and Vine District is that those plans were never really fully discussed. And so we're doomed to sort of go through this argument every five or six years.
But let me say this. In comparison to the baseball museum, you always have an exhibit. You always have traffic coming in there. So people are behind the scenes saying, well, Greg Carroll needs to do more to get people down there to increase the revenue. They have Rhythm and Ribs, but there's no real program or event to attract people down there year-round, whereas the Negro League Museum, they always have something, some award program, something so that they
What was always curious to me, though, Lynn, is that there was an effort to cut $125,000 in funding. There was a protest of that at City Hall, so now they decide to cut that back to $65,000, as you point out. There was also a big plan to cut $2 million from indigent services at Truman Medical Center and at the Samuel Rogers Clinic. And now, again, outcry there. Now that's cut back to $500,000. So where did they eventually find that money so quickly to stop those cuts from taking place when they were so desperate just a few weeks ago?
Well, the budget originally provided money for inaugural events for the city council, and they said, no, we're not going to have the taxpayers pay for that. We'll get that from donations. So that raised some money for the Jazz Museum. And they've recalculated the amount of money they hope to bring in from the ambulance service, so that will help the indigent care providers. So some of it is budget, budget estimating.
And just very quickly, watch carefully. I bet the money for the Jazz Museum is put back in by the end of the fiscal
Alrighty.
Year.
Alrighty, we'll watch for it. That is our weekend review. Our thanks to our news reviewers from the Star, Lynn Horsley, and from the Call, Eric Wesson. Steve Vockrodt is from the Pitch, and Dave Helling is with your Kansas City Star. Did you know that cancer is the number two leading cause of death in the nation, but the number one killer in Kansas and Missouri? Join me Thursday night at 8 for a special program, Cancer in KC, connecting the dots on cancer's impact in the metro. We'll see you then. I'm Nick Haines from all of us at KCPT. Thanks for spending part of your weekend with us.